endurance, aggression, and technique. That's what we're all about here at MMA Heat. I'm Karyn Bryant, welcoming you to the show, coming to you from Fortune Gym in Los Angeles, California, and here's what's in store for you today. We're going to spend some time with a third man in the octagon, the legendary Herb Dean. We've also got Frank Trigg, former UFC fighter, is going to tell us what it was like taking MMA to Israel. And we also have former mobster and porn producer turned fighter Kenji Gallo on how MMA redeemed him. But first, we're going to get started with Jared Hamman. This guy is in the UFC. He is a light heavyweight, and he's known to his friends as Mr. Fight of the Night, thanks to the back-to-back honors he earned for the Kyle Kingsbury and Rodney Wallace fights. He's definitely known for his aggression and his heart in the octagon, and he's a former college football player, so we sat down and talked to him about making the transition from the gridiron to the cage. Take a look. You know, Jared, we hear a lot of talk about people worrying that football is too dangerous for their children. Here you are, an MMA fighter who previously played football. So what's your take on the whole situation? Which one is more dangerous? Which one do you think you can get hurt in more?
I honestly think that that football is maybe more dangerous than MMA, just because you can get blindsided by a guy that you're not, at least in MMA, you can see what's coming at you, I guess you could say.
Right.
But in football, you can get stuff, you can get an offensive lineman hit you in the knees, or you can hit, you know, from a spot that you don't see, from a blind side or whatever. And that's usually when people get hurt in football,
right.
When they don't see something coming at them. But then again, it's funny, because I was just telling you the story. You know, I my mom wanted me to play football for forever, and then my uncle actually talked her into it, and then I played football for 9 years, and then my mom, when I started doing MMA, my whole family was like, oh, we're worried about you getting hurt, we're worried about this happening. I'm like, what is going on? I played football for 9 years, and I was hurt every single day.
How was that transition, though, then getting into MMA more and you know, taking off the gear, stripping it down a little bit and getting in there to mix it up hand to hand?
It was you know, like, again, I took all the training that I learned from my coaches, the mindset, I guess,
yeah,
you could say, into MMA. So it was fun, you know, being able to fight, because in football you can't really punch, you can hit,
right?
But you can hit, but you can't strike.
Yeah.
Like, so it's really weird, you know. So
and
now
you can grab and you can throw,
you can grab,
but you can't.
You can throw, but
yeah,
you can't,
yeah.
You can't strike unless you want to get ejected. So it's cool actually,
right,
being able to, you know, fight, and then you can fight one on one.
Right.
So it's
right,
kind of, you know, it's kind of a cool transition.
But discipline-wise, your head was probably pretty fit for that. I mean, because you know, you hear a lot. MMA fighters, obviously, you know, you got to work hard, you got to push it, you got to, you know, till you're puking, and then you got to keep going some more. And so do you think you were prepared for the mental game of MMA?
Yeah.
Well prepared?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, with the training that we did in college and going through different hell weeks and going through, you know, three practices a day sometimes,
mm-hmm,
that definitely prepared me mentally.
Right.
At our school, our motto was mental toughness, extreme desire. And that was just instilled in us from day one of football camp.
Right.
And so definitely mentally wise, the playing football helped me with my mental toughness and trained me up for the MMA, you know, training and whatnot.
Yeah.
So for sure.
Well, we talk a lot about entertainment and MMA crossing over together. So do you have a favorite fight movie? Anything that you do before your fights to maybe amp you up, like, or to get you in the spirit of an upcoming fight?
This is actually funny. My coach, we were on our road games to an away game or whatever,
yeah,
we were never allowed to listen to music or do anything.
Really?
Because it gets you, if you listen to really loud music, it gets your adrenaline pumping way too fast.
Okay.
And crash.
Yeah, right.
And I actually learned from that. And so now I actually listened to Norah Jones before my fight.
Really?
It's funny, because I see that,
like,
and I calm and relax.
So
I listen to Norah Jones,
nice,
or, you know, some calm music, so I don't,
right,
get my, you know, too juiced up.
Right, right.
And then I go on my, then when I go with my warm up, then I get a little different, but.
Yeah.
But I honestly don't get really jacked up before a fight, because I love doing it.
Right,
I'm
right,
real calm and ready to go.
So you're calm in your locker room?
Yeah,
you're pretty
absolutely
chill?
I just try and chill. Just basically keep my mind off of it.
Yeah.
And just, you know, stay focused on other things. I like to talk. I'll bring a book or something like that. And just, you know, just stay calm.
Like what kind of book, though?
I'm a history major.
I'll take
you know, something. I usually like to read biographies. So
okay,
read,
so you're reading like Andrew Jackson while you're just flipping through
something like that. Yeah. Well, right now I'm actually reading the book on Drew Brees.
Oh, nice. Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
And he's a Christian, and so I'm a Christian.
Okay.
So it's nice seeing the parallels and whatnot with him and his camp and going from San Diego to
right
Saints and whatnot. So.
And you have a good time training with Vladimir Matyshenko and Anthony Hardonk. You guys have a pretty solid team here.
We have a, you know, real solid team. We work well together.
Mm-hmm.
We've been together now for about, I think I would say 3 years, maybe 4 years.
Yeah.
And we just got our routine down, and we're good to go.
I think I asked Vlad once, but out of the three of you, if there was a three-way fight, who would win?
Trigg did rep?
No.
It depends. Well, this is funny. I say for black shit, and actually says on television.
If you don't want to, you can play.
I say if we do a round and then take shots and then
Okay, no, that'd work. Vlad's a tough guy.
Very
tough guy. Well, if it ever comes to that, call us. We want exclusives on that footage. All right.
Yes.
Cool.
Yes, yes.
Jared is not lying. Vlad can put away the vodka. If you want proof, you need to look at our interviews on MMAHeat.com. Up next, Frank Trigg on taking MMA to Israel. Welcome back to MMA Heat. I'm Karyn Bryant. Still to come, Herb Dean will give us the truth about the eye poke rule. But first, Frank Trigg. He is known as a commentator and a fighter, of course. He's a former UFC welterweight, and he recently was involved in the IFC Genesis event over in Israel. He talked to us about what it was like taking MMA to such an historic place, and he also gets philosophical about the four heat principles.
From a trip to Israel.
Yeah.
You're fighting over in Israel. Can you tell me how that even came together? Because I didn't know. Obviously, we know that MMA is an international sport, but I didn't know that it had gotten to the point where they were putting on big promotions over there.
Well, it was the first fight, actually, the first real fight in Israel, and it was done pretty well. It was done in the in Tel Aviv, where it was, mm-hmm. and it's in the basketball arena. They have a really good basketball team. I don't know if it's the European circuit or whatever, but they have a really good basketball team. It's 12,000 seat arena, did it 8,000 fans, gave away 2,000 tickets, sold 6,000.
Yeah.
And they were upset, they didn't sell out. Like, they totally thought they were gonna sell out over there.
Right.
It was the first fight they ever had, so you gotta kinda give them a little bit of leeway to kinda build up a little, mm-hmm. but it was a very good show, it ran very nicely. Israel was really good. I really liked it. Hopefully they have another fight March or April, and I'll be able to go back again. I mean, it was really that nice where I even want to bring the wife and kids this time, because if you get a chance to go to the Dead Sea, you get a chance to go to Jerusalem and see, you know, I'm a big gamer, and I play Assassin's Creed, which is basically built around, that's what it's for.
Yeah.
And so now Brotherhood just came out, so now I'm trying to get Brotherhood to watch so I can play that on 360. And then, but it's the scenes that I actually went and walked it. I was like,
that's cool.
And like, I know this stuff. And then when you get there, you're like, oh, wow, this is where Christ walked with his cross.
Right.
Whether you're Christian or not, just to you as a historical fact, this is where he walked. So I went and did the 14 spots. I'm like, dude, it's like, on the movies, it's like a 15-mile walk. It's not. It's like a mile.
Well, no, dude.
It's kind of like, wow, this is kind of silly.
But that's the great thing about the oral tradition and history.
Yeah.
I mean, these things, you know. But and you won the fight, we should say.
Yeah. Let's, you know, for me, I'm such a... For people that know me, my history is kind of like my thing, so doing stuff like that, I kind of forget I went over to the fight. It's kind of weird. I was like, well, actually, I got a fight here. What the hell's happening? But yes, and plus, too, when you're in Israel, you're just, you know, 4 or 5 hours from Valley of the Kings, mm-hmm. so it's like the pyramids in Cairo, and you're only 3 or 3.5 hours away from Mecca, which is the three major religious sites in the old world are all right there within a couple hours of each other. So you're kind of in the center of it all, so it makes it kind of nice. Then, you know, they add into, you know, too, that I got a first round knockout.
Nice.
You know, kind of helped out quite a bit, too. It was like, oh, great, first round knockout.
Cool.
I'm all done. Didn't get hit.
I was just going to say, you had to stay pretty and you're good. You're good. Our show is called MMA Heat, and heat is for heart, endurance, aggression, and technique.
Okay.
Okay, I believe those are the four elements to make the best fighters, and you got to have that. So I'm curious if you've got a fight that you remember showing one of those qualities the most. You know, like, was there one fight where you really dug deep, showed more heart, one fight where your aggression took over, one fight where you were so technically, you know, precise that that's what got it done, or, you know, just fights that stand out to you?
I work in the opposite.
Okay.
I remember the fights that stole my heart.
Okay.
The fights that stole my aggression, the fights that stole, because that's how I operate in the losses more than the wins.
Right.
Everybody can win and learn from your wins. It's very easy to do that. Mm-hmm. It's very hard to learn from your losses because you have to go back and like relive that moment all the time. So like, mm-hmm. I remember at the end of I had more heart and that's what kind of dragged me out of it.
Yeah.
You know, or I had more, you know, more aggression and that's what kind of got me in, you know, kept me in this fight.
Mm-hmm.
I know the ones that kind of stole, I didn't have enough, like the Robbie Lawler fight, my aggression stopped and that's the reason why I spun into the corner because I wanted to take a break because I was stopped being aggressive.
Right.
And that's why I get knocked out.
Right.
I remember that I knew for sure I was going to meet Matt Hughes in that second fight. Like, I knew for sure it was going to happen. And I had him really make a choke. And then he fell out of it. And that's the fight that stole my heart.
Do you believe that you can teach heart?
You can teach heart, but it's taught by your parents when you're 2 and 3 and 4 years old. When you finally get to that space where it's time to be an athlete, you can't teach it anymore. Your kid's got it, kid doesn't. I've seen tons of guys that we call them war a locker room warrior, where they should be the world champ in the locker room. They're in here inside the cage, and we're training with them. These guys should be world champs, man. These guys kick everybody's ass in the gym. Put them underneath the lights, and they fall apart. Oh, it's mental. Oh, it's this, it's that. It's like, no, man, the kid doesn't have the heart for the sport. He just doesn't have the heart for the sport. That's the way it is. Some guys that I beat the crap out of in here. I mean, I beat the living piss out of them out of here. And they go fight. Holy crap, who is that? Who is that guy? Where's that guy in the training room? It's just a difference of guys. And you see it in the guys, you know the guys, you know, it's not the aggressive guys, it's not the guys that got big mouths or cocky, whatever. You can see the guys that have heart, and it runs the gamut, you know, I'm super cocky, I got a huge ego, like that's my game. But then Martin Cameron has got as much heart, if not more heart than I do, and he's very quiet, very good. Randy Couture is the same way. He's got more heart than I do.
Yeah.
But he's totally the opposite genre and mentally and how he reacts. But yeah, heart can't be taught to someone by the time you get them as a coach. Mm-hmm. Heart is taught when they're kids. So it's up to the parents to teach the kid heart.
If you'd like Frank to beat on you and test your heart, you can always find him at Extreme Couture out in Las Vegas. Now, still to come right here on MMA Heat, referee Herb Dean will talk rules, street fighting, and swearing. Stay with us. Welcome back to MMA Heat. I'm Karyn Bryant. Still to come on the program, Kenji Gallo. He's a former mobster and porn producer, and he's going to talk about how MMA saved him. But first, we have got the legendary Herb Dean. This man is pretty much the most recognizable ref in MMA, known for his great technique, certainly. He's been at the job for over a decade and has had the sweetest seat in the house for some amazing fights. Find out why Herb thinks he has got pretty much the best job in the entire world. So, Herb Dean, you are pretty much regarded as the best MMA ref, I think. The most favorite, certainly. You won again at the MMA Awards this year.
Oh, that was great. That was great. Yeah. Okay, now I got screamed at because I didn't thank the commission and my
speech. Oh, okay.
So, you know, I didn't work last time.
And, right.
You know,
right.
I think, well, I don't know. So, hey, I'm just the guy who's out there. There's a lot of people. There's right. The commissioners. There's the timekeepers. There's the inspectors. Right. But, so I'm just happy that people in this sport take the time to appreciate the people who make it a sport and not a felony. So, you know, I thought it would be thankless, and the fact that it's not is surprising.
What are their rules that you think people misunderstand the most or get wrong the most?
Let's see, the intelligent defense, that there's a set number of unanswered punches that means you're going to stop a fight. Like, there's a number in stone. Every situation is different.
It seems as though people misunderstand what you get for an eye poke. Does the clock stop? Do you get 5 minutes? Do you not get 5 minutes? Who's the one that determines whether the fighter should go on? That, to me, whenever there's an eye poke, mayhem ensues.
You know what? You're right. That's the most misunderstood rule. The only foul where a fighter mandatorily gets 5 minutes is a groin kick.
Right.
Low blow. That's where the fighter can say, I get my five. I'm in control of this. I have 5 minutes, and I wish to take three of them, or four, or all five. For other injuries, the referee, in conjunction, most likely with the doctor, with the physician, will decide how much time he gets up to five.
Okay.
So he can say, well, you know what, well, I'm going to give you 2 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'm going to give you five, or mm-hmm. But up to five, but the referee decides.
Do people come up to you in the street ever and say, oh man, Herb, you stopped that fight too soon, or you let that go too long? Does that ever happen to you?
Yes, they do. yes.
What's your response, and to which fights have they said that to you?
There's been quite a few some different fights over the years, and, you know, I'm there to do as my conscience dictates. So that's what I do. Not. I'm not there for anyone else's reasons. I'm the one who has to live with my decisions, and so that's where that stops.
And plus, you always have your mouth guard in your front pocket, so if they want to go, right?
I'm ready. Well, I'm gonna start doing that. You know, I'm gonna get my mouth guard. I'm gonna have it in the pocket. You know,
bring it.
Right.
Bring it.
What? I'm ready.
And we should say that you fight as well. I mean, you know, that's part of the reason you were, you know, getting into repping beforehand. You were going to the fights, but partly because you were also a fighter in your own time, right?
I used to compete, not very much, but every now and then. Mm-hmm. And then now this is a grown-up sport, so referee should referee, fighters compete. But back, that's how I got into this.
Yeah.
I enjoy the sport. I like the sport, and I like training, and I like to compete every now and then. It's the only thing that would, like, make me jog a lap or two, you know, the thought of, like, a public embarrassing butt kicking, so, you know, yeah.
Well, were you good? Are you good still? Because you still train, obviously. Oh, come on. Don't be so humble. You know you were good.
I've had some good days. I've had a couple of good days, you know? Yeah.
What's your signature move?
Let's see. Signature move. I like to try to kick people in the head. So that's what I like to do.
That's a good move. Well, you're hoping they're bringing back the pride rules in UFC, right? Could you imagine?
Right.
Well, I mean, back in the day, I mean, when you look at some of the old fights of the guys just getting soccer kicked in the head, I mean, it's a little dicey, right. But
you have to train that, too. I fought under those rules, and I forgot the soccer kick when I could have, you know?
It's the killer.
Because you didn't train it, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's the put-away move right there.
Right. Yeah.
So when you're reffing, I know you're supposed to be impartial, and I know that you are.
I am.
But what moments have stood out to you that you've seen in the octagon, in the cage, that you know, your inner dialogue just went, whoa?
Well, there's a lot of them that my inner dialogue and my accidental outer dialogue happened to. Definitely the Tim Sylvia arm bar when he broke his arm. Yeah. That was pretty.
And what did you say?
Something like some old crap or something like that. It's somebody updated my Wikipedia and put it on there. So I gotta do something about that. Can you do something about that?
Anybody can edit Wikipedia. We can go do it after the
interview. Yeah, we gotta go edit that, man. There's somebody, you know, like, that's not what I want to be known for, is the, what is that, expletives?
Yes.
That I used in an exciting situation.
Yes. Well, you know. You're better than that.
That shouldn't be on my Wikipedia. But, just the other day, the Pettis. Mm-hmm. The Pettis.
Kick off the wall.
Kick off the wall, yeah.
That was phenomenal.
Yeah.
You got to love Herb Dean. Now, if you're looking for a career change, Herb runs a referee school out of the Fight Academy in Pasadena. You should definitely check it out. Up next, find out who's tougher, mobsters or MMA fighters. You're watching MMA Heat. I am Karyn Bryant, and I want to introduce you now to Kenji Gallo. He's the author of a book called Break Shot, A Life in the 21st Century American Mafia. This guy's a former mobster and porn producer who once wore a wire as an informant against the Colombo crime family. Kind of scary. So we went to a very wide open place with a lot of spectators to sit down and talk to him about life as a gangster and how MMA redeemed him. Take a look. Talk to you about a few things because you've lived an interesting life. What'd you do before you were fighting?
Before I was fighting, I was a bookie for the Colombo family. I was a pornographer. I worked for the LA mob, and I wore a wire for the FBI for 8 years.
Okay, and so this is what the book is about, basically, is your life leading up to wearing the wire?
Correct. Well, it's all of it, even including wearing the wire. Okay. It's Break Shot was the code name that the FBI gave to me.
Okay. So this is incredible to me, and this is why we're out here in public, Kenji, because, you know, do you still have enemies?
Oh, of course.
How is it that you're able to just be out here chilling, smiling, going to gyms, fighting, writing books about what you did, and you're not, you know, getting blown up?
Because, I mean, the Colombo family's not what it was once, and I'm in California where everything's sunny, and the more stuff I do and the more public I am, the less they can do to me.
Okay. True. Good point. So in a nutshell, how did you get into doing all that? Where'd you grow up? How did you get started in all that?
I grew up in Orange County, California. Mm-hmm. I went to a really good school. In fact, I went to school with Will Ferrell and a bunch of other guys against from Rage Against the Machine. I just decided that I wanted to go on a different path.
I guess so.
A really bad path. And my goal, like in my yearbook even says, I'm going to go to New York, I'm going to be a gangster. And that was my life's goal, and I accomplished it. You got to be careful what you wish for.
Yeah, totally.
It wasn't the right choice, but at the time, it seemed like it was, glamorous, and mm-hmm. it just didn't turn out to be.
Mm-hmm. The first time you walked into a room with some of these guys and you had a wire on, how'd it feel?
I felt a little apprehensive. I felt I get that cold trickle of sweat going down the back of my back. Kind of like before you fight, you get the same one. You're like, well. But then after a while, I felt, and at first I kind of had like, because there's most of the guys I really could care less about, but there's a couple guys that I liked, that I had grown fond of over the years, and I felt like I was betraying them. But then like as I started working with the FBI more and I started pulling away from the life, I started to see that no one's my friend.
No.
And I'm not going anywhere with this. I'm going to be dead or in prison.
So how did you make the transition then from being a gangster, being a porn maker, all of that stuff, into being a fighter?
Well, the FBI came to me and they made me a deal and they gave me a new start and I decided to wear the wire. So after my time was up, I spent literally, like I had always trained. I was in Jeet Kune Do before and I trained since I was a kid. I wrestled, I boxed. And then when the FBI moved and they put me in their protection program, I had to sit in a hotel for 9 months by myself. And then it came into, it went even farther, over a year. And while I was there, on my third day there, as I was jogging around early in the morning because I was scared to go outside at first, I saw a jiu-jitsu place. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, I'll go do that.
And you train at Fortune Gym, you train at Rain.
Correct, I train at Rain.
You love to bang, don't you?
Oh yeah, I train with the best guys at Rain and the best guys at Fortune, so. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Rain is really kind of special down there. It's a really great vibe.
Oh, really good, man. I mean, the team's really great. Mm-hmm. Munoz is great. I mean, it's a special place.
You like to beat up Mayhem and Benji Raddick, don't you? I've seen it firsthand.
I don't like to beat up Mayhem. I like to beat up Benji Raddick. Benji Raddick and I have something because Benji, Kenji.
Oh, that's true. I never thought that.
We trade insults on Facebook all the time. He's always like, oh, New Year, coming to get you now.
Not to get too philosophical, but do you think that more gangsters should learn the martial way in a way? You know what I mean? About honor? I mean, you've really seen kind of both sides of honor and valor, I think, by having been in the mob and then working out with guys that, you know, really whose hearts and minds and spirits are in the right place.
Well, I really believe that, like, MMA, jiu-jitsu kind of saved my life, and I think that if we can get more at-risk teens and more people to do it, it gives them a positive outlook. It gives you something to do. And it makes you, a lot of people think it'll make you more aggressive, it'll make them do it. It won't. Because then you learn, like, the consequences of everything, and you learn that you don't need to prove yourself to somebody. If somebody says something stupid to you, like, who cares? Like, because you, in your mind, you know you can destroy them, so what's the point?
Very nice. Well, good luck with everything, Kenji. And again, you know, I love hanging out with you, but I might not get in the car until you start it.
Okay. I understand.
If you'd like to see more about Kenji's life, check out a documentary called Flipped, A Mobster Tells All. The Discovery Channel did it. It is pretty cool. Well, that does it for us here at MMA Heat. I want to thank everybody here at Fortune Gym for their hospitality. I want to remind you that you can join our Facebook fan page, and you can also follow MMA Heat and me on Twitter. That does it. I'm Karyn Bryant. Gotta go get my workout on. I'll see you next time.